I'd also like to introduce our next speaker. So Beth Kallmeyer, MSW, is the Vice President of Care and Support for the National Alzheimer's Association based in Chicago. As Vice President of Care and Support, Ms. Kallmeyer oversees association programs and services nationwide for individuals with Alzheimer's and their families, outreach to long-term care professionals, and diversity and inclusion initiatives. These services include information and referral through the association's 24/7 helpline, consumer education workshops, support groups for caregivers, programming for persons with early stage dementia, as well as initiatives to influence quality care delivery and long-term services. Ms. Kallmeyer has more than 25 years of experience working for nonprofit organizations in both direct service and leadership roles. She has been with the Alzheimer's Association since 2001. Prior to working for the Alzheimer's Association, she was employed as a social worker in various settings, including emergency services, community mental health, and hospice. Ms. Kallmeyer has a bachelor's degree from St. Mary's College of Notre Dame and an MSW from the Jane Addams College of Social Work at the University of Illinois in Chicago. Please help me welcome to the stage Beth Kallmeyer.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm so pleased to be here today and speaking to you after lunch, right? Now, I want to thank Claire Day and Elizabeth Edgerly and the Northern Cal, Northern Nevada chapter for having me come out here to speak at such a successful event. And I'm really honored that I get to be here at your 20th anniversary. So cheers to you for that. Today we're going to talk this afternoon right after lunch about defining quality care. So you guys ready? Yeah. Awesome. This is a pretty good group. Oh, I got a point here. Got it. Before we go into quality care, I did want to just talk a little bit about Alzheimer's and dementia and the facts and figures around that. I've been here all morning and listened to the other speakers, and I know you're all here because you understand that dementia is a prevalent condition that the people that we work with as professionals are, we're facing it all the time. But I think it's really important for us to remember how many people are dealing with this disease. I gotta go this way, this is very complicated. So, the epidemic continues to grow. There's 5.7 million Americans today living with Alzheimer's disease. That doesn't include dementia. For reasons that we heard about this morning from Dr. Rosen, it's difficult to separate out and to count some of the different dementias. But nonetheless, we have a lot of people living with this today. We also know that this year, 2018, around an estimated 700,000 people in the US with Alzheimer's will have Alzheimer's when they die. So you're probably aware that when people die with this disease, sometimes it's on their death certificate, sometimes it's not. But we do know that it complicates other diseases. And you know, the greatest risk for Alzheimer's is age. When you're older, there's comorbid conditions. We have to keep those things in mind. Alzheimer's and dementia is going to complicate all of those. So one of the other things that we heard Elizabeth talking about this morning in terms of the increased funding, the reason this is important is if you look at this slide, you can see that from 2000 to 2015, Alzheimer's deaths have increased by 123%, while for other diseases, they've decreased significantly. If you look at those other diseases, heart disease, diabetes, HIV/AIDS, they have all been funded at significantly higher rates by the federal government. So, you know, whatever you want to think about the government does a great job funding research for diseases, and so we need to continue to support that so that we can see a different pathway here for Alzheimer's disease. Also, we talked to somebody this morning, I forget who now, was talking about cost. This is the costliest disease right now in this country. We know that cost in 2018 is going to be more than $277 billion. That's the cost of care. That has nothing to do with research dollars. So when we think about how much we're putting toward care every year, we have to think about what we can do to delay or stop this disease ultimately. So it's a big problem. Just wanted to sort of frame that up. I know that today I have the pleasure to talk to a group of mostly professional people in long-term services and supports, in hospitals, in other medical settings, dealing with people with Alzheimer's disease. And that's what the Alzheimer's Association was really set out to do in terms of defining what quality care looks like. You know, we struggle with figuring out the medical reasons for Alzheimer's disease and how to treat it. Also doing research on psychosocial interventions is really difficult. I think the psychologists that were talking this morning and everyone else would say that doing research on psychosocial interventions, period, is more difficult because there's so many other factors to rule in or rule out. That doesn't mean we shouldn't do it. So we're happy to be able to share with you the evidence-based dementia care practice recommendations. So a word about the history of this. The Alzheimer's Association has been involved in looking at this and looking at how you define quality care for many, many years, starting with the guidelines for dignity, key elements of dementia care, and in the about 2006, 2007 was the first version of the dementia care practice recommendations. So when we decided that it was time, that we thought there was enough research to do an updated version, we really did a lot of work talking to other experts in the field, researchers, leaders in the field in terms of thought leaders around how they're providing care, and looked at the format that we had previously had and came up with what we then published in the gerontologist in February this year. Here's a set of the different authors. So you might, if you're familiar with any of the research in these areas, you can see that these are well-known folks that have been doing this type of research for a long time. There we go. So what we came out with the recommendations was we looked at where's the evidence? Where does evidence exist? Sometimes it was about best practices. We still have gaping holes in terms of evidence. There's no evidence out there that shows that training actually translates to competency. Did you know that? So that's a problem, isn't it? I mean, we have to figure something out about how we're going to show that when we implement quality care, that it makes a difference not only for the person living with the disease, but for your staff and for the people that are providing the care. We've been talking about person-centered care since when? Who knows? I mean, a long time. Do y'all think you're providing person-centered care all the time? Why is that? Yes, it's very hard to do. It's hard to do because what we're trying to, when you're providing person-centered care, you're thinking about how do I make this as much like the person's home as I can? And they're not in a home when you're doing that. And so there's systems bumping up against each other. So it's difficult. Does that mean we shouldn't try? And does that mean we shouldn't do it? No, right? We have to keep trying. I'm not going to promise you it's easy, but when I'm going to go through the recommendations today. There's 56, so I can't talk about all of them in depth. They'll give me the hook. But I've been promised they'll give me the hook. But when we're going through these, what I'd like you to do is think about your own work settings. Think about the people living with Alzheimer's or dementia that you're caring for, that you interact with, or that you treat, and think about how you could do something differently. It's not, training's important, right? We know in our hearts that people need to be trained, even though there's no evidence to show that it matters. But it's true, we need to get some evidence, we need to do some research. But we also need to figure, training isn't the only thing. We have to get at the system. The system is gonna undo what training does in any given day, right? So we have to think about how can we talk to the thought leaders? How can we talk to the administrators? How can we talk to the owners of some of the organizations and facilities that will allow us to make changes that will ultimately make a better experience for people living with Alzheimer's disease? So the other thing I can tell you about the recommendations, they're designed for professional care providers. They are not, they're designed across settings. So whether it be in adult day, whether it be in residential care, assisted living, continuing care communities, in-home care, you know, what we decided in the group that we pulled together to help us put these recommendations together was that person-centered care is person-centered care. It doesn't matter where it's being delivered. It's not different if you're doing it in hospice or if you're doing it in a hospital or if you're doing it in an assisted living, that it is the same, and we needed to think about it in those ways. One of the things that we did, though, we divided it into these different sections that you see here on the slide, really looking at specific recommendations in these different areas, and we thought that it was the best way to sort of break it down. So there's a lot to think about. That's the reality. When we're providing care for people living with Alzheimer's, we have to think about a lot. So hopefully these will give some we'll give you some direction and some things to think about as you leave here today. For some reason, I can't get the right angle to make it move along. There we go. So the first set of recommendations, and there's actually articles that go with each of these. If you go to the Alzheimer's Association website, I'll have a link at the end. If you want to read all the different articles, you can certainly do that. But the first things that we talk about, of course, are what's the evidence for person-centered care? And why is that important? And what are those recommendations? So, you know, knowing the person, right? That's such an easy thing to say. There's nothing I'm going to talk about today that you're going to say, I've never heard anyone say that before. There's nothing groundbreaking in this. I think what's groundbreaking is we're getting more evidence around it to show that it works so that we can prove it, which is important. But we also have to think about how can we do things differently so that we are incorporating these things and so that we're not just talking about person-centered care as if, it's the thing to say, but nobody really knows what it looks like when it gets implemented. So knowing the person means having a relationship with the person. It means having your staff, challenging them to have a relationship with people living with the disease. So, you know, when we think about how that might connect to consistent assignments, right, that's going to be important. Agency staff coming into a nursing home and providing care on a regular basis, are they going to be able to know the person? No, not very well. I understand that there's needs for those things sometimes, but I also think that as leaders in this room, to think about what can you do to make sure that people are having those consistent assignments and make sure that you're supporting the idea that it is important for them as part of the care team, the frontline providers, to really know who that person is and to get to know their family. When I say person-centered care, you can assume that I'm saying person and family-centered care. I was just talking to a woman the other day who was thinking of moving her husband who had moderate, getting to late stage Alzheimer's into a residential facility. And she wanted to know what questions to ask. Well, there's a lot, right? And she couldn't talk on the phone. She only wanted it in an email. So I said, all right. So ultimately I said, you know, they need to think of you as a member of the care team. That's gonna be the most important thing. You've been the caregiver. You need help, you need to be joining that team and ask them how they feel about that. That would be a place to start. And she said it opened up a whole bunch, and I gave her some other questions, of course, but that's really how we have to think about family members, even the ones that can be difficult, because they know that they do it better than anyone else. We're never gonna do it as well as they do it, and that's okay. But if we can invite them on our team, that's gonna help us. When we think about meaningful engagement, truly offering the person living with dementia an opportunity to engage, that every time that you're either talking with them or helping them with brushing their teeth, or you're helping them get dressed or eating. Those are opportunities for engagement. So this is where some of the training comes in. Our staff have to understand they might have a checklist of 15 things to do that morning, but on that checklist shouldn't be bathe Mr. Smith, feed Mr. Jones, you know, take Miss whoever down to the activity room. They shouldn't, if they see them as tasks to be checked off, we're not gonna get at what we're trying to do, right? They need to see them as opportunities to engage. Again, other recommendations around authentic, caring relationships. When you've all probably seen this happen, when there's an authentic, caring relationship between frontline staff and the person living with dementia, that's a better experience for everybody. It's a better experience for the people you're caring for and for your staff. And when you have staff that are having a better experience, what do you think that does translate to? Lower turnover, right? And that translates probably to savings somewhere. So thinking about building a supportive community, a supportive environment is important. And then evaluating our processes and our care practices. You know, one of the things that I'd ask for you to do today is to think about some of the things I'm sharing with you, take them back and think, all right, is my process supporting getting to know the person? What are the things that we do in our community when somebody moves in, or when we go into someone's home, or however we interact with people? What are the things that we have built into the system that help us get to know the person living with the disease? You know, it might be that the family and the person living with the disease fill out a form about them and what they like, and that's great. If you have that built in, that can be, I'm not talking about difficult stuff here, but thinking about putting it into the process and the structure of how you provide care, that's when we can make sure that those things happen, even if certain people, you know, you're gonna have staff turnover. Think about it this way, if you train a staff member and they leave, they're taking that training with them. But if you set up a process within the system that you're operating under to make sure that the staff have an opportunity to get to know the person, that's gonna be there all the time. That doesn't leave when somebody moves on to another position. So let's go on to the next category. Oh, before I do that, this, just so you can see, there is evidence around the effects of person-centered care. I know this is super tiny and I can't even read it from here either, so. You can find all this on the Alzheimer's Association website. But really, this here actually talks about reduction in staff turnover, that when there's a person-centered approach to care, and when those things are included in the way you're providing care, you're gonna have a reduction in staff turnover and other benefits for both the staff and the people that you're caring for. I'm really not loving the clicker. Okay. So, detection and diagnosis. This is sort of a new area that we looked at, and it's important because we know, say in assisted living, the facts and figures tells us 40% of those folks have dementia or Alzheimer's, 40%. That's probably underreported, right? In skilled nursing, it's 50%. In adult day, you're talking about 30%. So if you're working in long-term services and supports for seniors, you are interacting with people that have Alzheimer's disease. We also know of the 5.7 million people that have Alzheimer's, only about half have a diagnosis. We should be outraged about this, outraged. What doctor would not tell you you had some other fatal disease? I know it's complicated, we heard about that this morning. But it's getting better. And it's not okay that we're not getting those folks diagnosed. But the reality is we're not. So for this particular segment of the recommendations, we really wanted to highlight how important it is for all the people like you in this room that are taking care of individuals living with dementia that don't have a diagnosis, for you to recognize when you see changes. You might be working with, it might be at a AAA, it might be at a hospital, it might be in any of these other settings. It's not your job to diagnose them, it's not a diagnosis to talk about what are the warning signs that I'm seeing. I'm seeing a change in this person. And so these recommendations in this section are really about how do you make sure that your staff understand the difference between normal aging and dementia or Alzheimer's, and how do systems set up a pathway so that if you notice something, you tell somebody and you try and get that person connected to a place where they could get a diagnosis. Or you talk to the family, and it might not be, you know, if it's a CNA that goes into in home health and she's going into the home to do some bathing, notices some changes, she might not be the one that has the conversation with the family. She might not. But that you have a process in place so that you can have her talk to a supervisor who then might reach out or whatever seems to work best. But do you see where I'm going with this? We want people to be able to understand that this isn't normal aging and we should do something about it. We need to talk about it. So that's really what the detection and diagnosis segment is about. And we think it can be really important and hopefully drive people, more people, to get an appropriate and accurate diagnosis. So the next segment is really around assessment and care planning. So as a social worker, you know, this is near and dear to my heart. You can't make a care plan. You can't tell people what would be the next best thing for them to do if you don't first figure out where they are. You have to start where the person is. Start where the person living with dementia is. Start where their family members are. You know, part of my job at the Alzheimer's Association is overseeing our 24/7 helpline. And I can tell you that when somebody calls and has a question about Alzheimer's, I can't even begin to help them until I ask 5 or 6 or 7 questions. Because, you know, it matters what stage of the disease they're in, it matters where they live, it matters if they have any money, it matters if they have any family supports, it matters, I mean, all of these things matter and they make a difference in terms of what kind of care plan am I gonna suggest to them. So assessment is important, and I know when you go into assisted living, when you go into long-term care, when you go into a day center, when home health comes into your home, there's always an assessment done the first time. So that's great. You know what we don't do? We don't reassess. Well, this is a disease that's progressive. It changes, and family situations change. Caregiver, we heard about what happens to caregivers. We need to reassess probably every 6 months, depending on the situation, or whenever there's a change, so that we can accurately make sure that we have the right care plans in place. We also need to communicate the care plan. Somebody was joking earlier about, you know, person-centered care is filling out a form. It can't just be about filling out a form. If we don't offer our staff an opportunity to share what they've learned through assessments and to have regular conversations about their patients or the residents, then we're not really supporting person-centered care. Lots of people on the team that interact with the person living with the disease have information, and we need to figure out ways that we can share that within the systems that you have. Because otherwise it's just a file, and who opens up the file to read the file? When's the last time you did that? Right? So we need to talk to each other about what we're doing. In terms of some of the pieces of the assessment, we need to be looking, obviously, at the experience of the person living with disease and their care partner or caregiver, depending on where they are in the disease process. We also need to look at their function and the behavior and what those issues are. And then finally, their health status. We know, as we said, there's other comorbidities. There's other things going on. And once you layer Alzheimer's or dementia across that, you have a much, much more complicated situation. Really not loving the clicker. Okay. Other things that we need to be assessing are obviously neurocognitive function. We need to understand where they're at. We need to look at decisional capacity. And we need to think about the physical function. What are things that people can do and what can they do if they have a little bit of assistance? Not doing it for them, but really helping figure out what can they do. where are they psychologically, socially, spiritually? What is their sense of well-being? What types of everyday activities do they want to participate in? What's interesting to them? What do they need help to do? What could they do if they had a little bit of help? Those types of things are critical. And of course, behavioral changes and any symptoms around that, very important to continue to assess. The other thing that the recommendations really focus on is using a strengths-based approach. You know what, that's really hard to do when we're talking about deficits, right? But thinking about what the person can still do rather than what they can no longer do helps everybody engage with them on a different level. What if this person gets a little bit of help, they can actually brush their teeth. If I walk them through this process, they can get dressed on their own. If I model a little bit, they can feed themselves. So these are important things to think about doing and important for us to assess so that we know where they're at. All right, I'm gonna actually move along here. So medical management recommendations around this are important. We've talked about that. The comorbidities that exist, the challenges that happen when people have, it's hard enough for older people without cognitive impairment to remember to take their medication and to do what the doctor tells them to do. It's difficult. Once you have somebody with dementia in there, it gets much, much more difficult. So we really want to think about how those comorbidities might impact the person living with the disease and their caregivers. We heard this morning, Dr. Rosen talked about behavioral and psychological symptoms. You know, we know that we don't want to use antipsychotics medication or psychotropic medication for people. We know that it's not good for them. And we also know that if you're using person-centered care techniques and you're really understanding and your team really understands what's happening for that person in terms of the disease process, that you're going to be less likely to need those. There's probably certain situations when the person's in such levels of distress that they, by a hallucination or by something else going on for them, that we need to think about those medications, but they need to be short-term and they need to be assessed frequently and taken off as soon as possible. The other thing that I think is really important in terms of the recommendations in the medical management piece is we have to have those end-of-life discussions. When people are diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease, it doesn't mean they can't think about early on, in particular, what they want their wishes to be at the end of life. So soon after a diagnosis, we need to encourage families to sit down and have these discussions because it is empowering for the person living with Alzheimer's disease to be able to say, all right, I've been diagnosed with this terrible disease, but I'm going to tell you how I want my care to go. And when families have those discussions and then they have to make difficult decisions at the end of life and they have to step in for that person, when they know they've had that discussion, it's still difficult because the person's dying, but it takes a huge burden off the family's shoulders in terms of saying, this is what Dad would have wanted, this is what we're gonna do. So as professionals, to encourage families to have those discussions, and I know we're going to hear more about this afternoon, so it's really critical, and it really can make a huge difference in the dying process for the whole family if those plans are in place. So information, education, and support. You know, we're the Alzheimer's Association. We're all about information, education, and support. So you can imagine that we think this is valuable, and it showed up in the recommendations. You know, we want to make sure that people that work for organizations where we're serving individuals living with Alzheimer's and dementia have access to information. We also want to make information, education, and support. We also want to make sure that their family members have access to that. Sometimes talking to a family member and being able to help them understand that this is a disease and this person isn't trying to drive you crazy by asking you the question 15 times, that can make a huge difference when you remind them it's a disease. So making sure families have access to that and to support along the way is really critical. I think another thing that's important is to think about support that can be delivered and that families have access to it that's culturally appropriate for them. I keep thinking if I stand in the right spot, I'm gonna have the clicker go. I'm gonna move through this a little bit quickly here. So when we look at ongoing care, there's recommendations around that. We talked a little bit about this, but the idea here, even though we're talking about deficits, we wanna support the functionality that the person has. So really working with them to help them do as much as they can in a way that's got dignity and that's respectful. Certainly around getting dressed, certainly around toileting, being able to give people, really support them in being successful at something is critical. And they might not be able to thank you for it, their communication might be impacted so to an extent that they can't, but the reality is it makes a difference for them. And certainly with eating, same thing. Eating should not be happening in somebody's bedroom. It needs to have people. Do you like to eat alone? I mean, we need to eat with other people. It's a social thing. It's a way to be connected. It's important that those things are supported and that we help families support that and that we also support that in our residential facilities. Again, on the website, you'll be able to see lots of different evidence, in particular around support for the ADLs and the recommendations. Ongoing care, behavioral and psychological symptoms of dementia. We talked about this a little bit. I just think, again, it's really important to never start with these as a first reaction to any kind of behavioral symptoms, that we really want to evaluate the environment and see what we can figure out about triggers and use those different skill sets in working with folks that are having a difficult time. So again, more evidence to show that some of these things are much more effective than the medications. We heard this morning that these medications actually aren't effective. We know this. Some things that are aromatherapy, massage, multisensory stimulation, even some bright light therapy. They're not huge studies, but we're seeing some good evidence there. We're also seeing good evidence in the validation therapy, reminiscence therapy, music therapy, pet therapy, engagement in meaningful activities. All of this matters. So when you think about what the person that's living with dementia, if they're engaged in the way that they can be throughout the day, they're going to be less likely to have these kinds of behavioral symptoms. So it's not an easy fix. If somebody's already at, super agitated or even aggressive, those are more difficult times. But the goal, of course, is to not get them there, right? So lastly, or almost last, I'm getting there. I told you there was 56 of these. So for the workforce, obviously we do think that orientation and training is important. We know that, as I said, there's no evidence that training translates to competency. We might be able to do some research and figure out that might be the case. But we need our staff to be trained. We need them to have access to information. We need to have a level of connectedness and collaboration around how we're providing care. Many years ago, I worked at a hospice, and that's always, it was like the best experience. You really have that multidisciplinary team. And once a week, we got together, all the doctor, the nurse's aides, I'm sure this still goes on, the social worker, the chaplain, and we talked about our entire caseload. We ran through everyone, and we shared observations. All of us had been in and out of the house that week, whatever it was. That was the way to give really good care. We communicated, everybody was respected. That's what we're talking about in terms of making sure that your staff are sharing information together. They're talking to each other. It's critical. And as I said, nothing groundbreaking about talking to each other about what we know. But you know what? We have to find ways to make that happen. And then, you know, as leaders in your organizations, you're the ones that set the stage. You're the ones that can have the ability to look at what your processes are. What are the systems you have in place? Are they supporting some of these recommendations? Or are they making some of these things much more difficult for your staff to implement? You're the ones that can make the changes there. And I think that's an important thing for you all to take back. And of course, you know, it's going to take time. The Alzheimer's Association is working on some different products to help beyond just training, but that we could help leaders in long-term services and supports really be able to deliver and implement these recommendations. One of the last areas is supportive and therapeutic environment. You know, this, again, is about building that sense of community for not just the people living there, if it's a residence, but for the staff as well, and everybody that's interacting with the person living with the disease. Dignity, of course, is important. Opportunities for choice, you know, as the disease progresses, the person might not be able to make some decisions, but they can always decide what they want to eat, if they want this or that. They can decide what they want to wear if you give them a choice. There's what they want to do that day, who they would like to sit by. I mean, we have to think about how do I give them opportunities to exercise choice. And again, meaningful engagement, we can't talk about that enough. Oh, one more. So transition coordination of services. You all know that this is super important, and this is where things get blown up a lot, right? When someone, they might have everything going on well in one setting, they get moved to the hospital, and they come back, and they're on three different meds and off the two that they were on before. We are smarter than this. We have to figure out how we can make that not happen. We, again, need to communicate with those folks, communicate during transitions. That's really, really important. I'm gonna move ahead. I wanna keep to my time, but I wanna show you. So lots of evidence you can find on the website. So, we actually worked with, we have a group of individuals living with Alzheimer's or dementia that serve as advisors for the Alzheimer's Association, and we took the recommendations to them, and they wrote a paper on it, so you can see that if you go to the website as well. And they didn't tell us anything, again, that was surprising, but here's some of the things that they did share with us. They wanted to talk about how important early diagnosis was, and detection and early diagnosis. They really thought that sharing information with each other, to share that appropriate information, was important. But getting to know the person, they wanted their independence maximized. I mean, this isn't surprising, right? They did ask for patience and compassion and the ability to adjust our approaches to people as their disease progressed. And lastly, really, to create a safe and supportive environment that's reflective of the person. So I think if you get a chance and you don't read anything else, I would ask you to read this article because it's really powerful coming from the voice of people living with Alzheimer's disease. So that, I just ran through the 56, and I didn't even talk about all of them because there's not time. I hope that you find some time to go check out the articles and know that as we move forward, there will be, as I said, some more products coming, programs coming from the Alzheimer's Association around this. And really what we're looking at is ways to help leadership in these organizations develop different systems so that we can support person-centered care in the way we deliver care and not just make it dependent on the one person that's good at it. So to wrap up, I'll just share a few things that I think you can take back. And when you think about how you're working with people living with the disease, you know, and Look at the way that, look at your own systems. Look at the things that are happening. Maybe develop a plan. No one's going to go back and say, I'm going to go implement 56 recommendations, Beth, right? I know this is not the case. It's not possible. We can start small, though, and we can make a difference and think about, maybe think about some of the different areas that we've put these topics into and say, how are we doing in transitions? How are we doing, and do we actually know the people that we're helping? How are we doing in understanding, does our team understand the difference between normal aging and dementia? So there's some things that you can do there, and talk to your staff about it. I think everybody wants to work in a supportive environment. I don't think anybody that works with seniors in long-term care is trying to do a bad job, right? Everybody wants to do a good job. We just have to help them. We set our staff up with systems that work against what they're trying to do and what they know is the right thing to do, and we have to think about that. So I would encourage you to go to alz.org/qualitycare. That is where you'll find all of the published articles, as well as some other materials for you. And I wish you luck, and thank you very much.